Usually I'm like prepared to, you know, if there's like disagreements, they're like within the, like, okay, I can see that. Right. This is,
I think
I need a sip of water.
Welcome to Every Album Ever with Mike and Alex. My name is Michael Mansour, and I'm joined as always by my patient, lovely, wonderful co-host, Alexander Volch. Say hello.
There we go.
There we go again.
Again.
This is Every Album Ever, the podcast where we listen to every single album in the world, one artist at a time. That's a new discography, even baby short ones like this episode, every episode. And today we'll be discussing every album by
The Laws.
The Laws. Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. Requested on Patreon. Patreon request by Scott. Scott's our old buddy. First, he requested The Clash. Check that episode out. It's very long and yes. Awesome. And I don't like The Clash. I'm kidding. I like The Clash. You don't like The Clash that much.
Yeah, I came out lukewarm. I thought
I don't like reggae. I like The Clash. And he also requested The Chameleons, which honestly, I like a lot more than The Clash. I'm already starting this episode off with very unpopular opinions, but I did like the Chameleons quite a bit. So thank you so much, Scott, for patronizing and fucking supporting and being rad. And he has a few other requests. I chose this one first because it's short.
It's one album.
And we have a big one that we're about to start that everyone has already seen because it came out last week. But it's just for time's sake, but we're going to get to some of his other requests that I'm excited, very excited for. Nice. But this is The Laws. The Laws, The Laws, The Laws. Oh, never heard them, I thought. And then I realized that I had heard them. And the world has heard them. A lot.
A lot.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, well, okay. So from what I understand, when we were like, man, we should start doing one album bands. So I looked up, like, you know, greatest like one-off albums.
Yeah.
And this is considered a very important album.
Yeah.
For some reason, I don't get it.
I think this is a perfect album. I'm not kidding. I can't believe you don't like it. I'm like outraged already. I'm going to keep this album forever. I love this fucking album.
I'm just waiting for you,
you know,
to tell me you're fucking with
me. We have a rule that we generally listen to every album two times. Mm-hmm. I have no idea how many times I listen to this. I listened to the fucking deluxe edition, all the outtakes and all the different versions. I listened to all of those. I fucking get it, dude.
I was not. I feel like I just woke up from a nap right now with that statement. Like, I need to like ground myself a little, like,
I can't
get a grasp of my surroundings.
I can't even grasp that someone could not enjoy this thing. It's a so fucking brilliantly written, performed like a beast. You hear, like, it's one album, but hearing these songs, look, these guys have been together forever. Like,
yeah.
You hear the chemistry, you hear how fucking tight they are. It's incredible. I don't know how you could you not,
because like, they were together forever.
But, I know. I learned that afterward. But
Oh man, I feel like I'm in a dream. Jesus, like, usually I'm like prepared to, you know, if there's like disagreements, they're like within the, like, okay, I can see that.
Right.
This is,
I
need a sip of water.
Please.
At most, I was expecting like lukewarm.
Oh no. So by the first song, I was already like, this is very satisfying. I'm already getting something here. Second song, I'm like, okay, I don't like the riffs are fairly generic. Like, they're not the most interesting riffs, but I was like, but the way they're taking the riffs into different places, like, that's smart. That's not normal. People don't, regular ass bands don't do that. By like halfway through the album, I was like, this is, you can't make this album bad for me at this point. I was already so on board. And by the end of it, I just kept putting it on over and over again. Like, oh, I fucking love it. And here's, everyone has heard
the song, There She Goes.
That, I hate that song.
Do you like it now?
No, I don't like it now. But
it's so perfect.
yes, exactly. So everyone has heard it from, you sent me the video and I had no idea why you sent, I watched the video. I was like, why the fuck did Al send me a commercial for, what is it, like birth control medication?
Yeah, like a Plan B type. Yeah.
And And I was listening to it. I was like, oh, I remember seeing this on TV. Like, why the fuck would he say it? I was like, oh, I hate this song. Why the fuck would he say it? And it took me a full day. It took me a full day because I hadn't started the album yet.
Oh, shit. Okay.
So when I finally went to the album, I was like, oh, no. Oh, no. No. I was so fucking terrified. So when the song came on the album, then I realized, like, oh, that was a cover on the commercials. And this version is better. It's not like a different song, but it's better. Yeah. And there's like a subtle changes that, or subtle things that the cover changed that ruined the song. Mm-hmm. I don't like the song now, but I get it. And it fits in with the context. It's 2 minutes. I fucking don't care. And after everything surrounding it, it's perfect. Yeah. It's perfect, Alex.
Man.
All right,
also,
now your turn.
Also, shout out to Connie, because that song came on and then we were texting and I was like, I never thought we'd be covering this song, but it's going to happen. And she's like, yeah, I always think about like abortions when I hear that song. I'm like,
and I love those too. This is a great album for everybody.
I was like, what? I know that was like in almost every late 90s, maybe even early 90s movie. I'm like, which one are you talking about? She's like, it was like a commercial, and she like went through like the commercial archives and
oh my god,
and found that. And then I assumed you would have listened to it by then.
I know. I
that's even better.
Yeah,
even better that you watched. We should put a link to the
commercial. You will. There will be a link to the commercial in the description for YouTube. But so
should we intro this thing, or?
Well, we didn't even start on talking about the band yet. Already we're complete opposite ends of the spectrum.
Yeah.
Complete positive, negative.
Yeah, they are from, I think also.
Like, oh, they're from Liverpool.
Yes, Liverpool. For some reason, they formed in 1983. Like,
they did.
Holy shit. And original member Mike Badger, which is a funny name because Badger. And then they'd bring in Mr. Lee Mavers on rhythm guitar.
Yep.
And he would find his way to the front of the band and
eventually just writing everything.
Yeah. And then John Power. Not Powers.
John Power.
Power.
It's even better.
On bass in 86. A lot of numbers going on here.
So the most amazing thing about this band is that they have one album, obviously very well regarded. Clearly, they went through a lot of shit to make that one album. The amount of members.
Insane.
Unbelievable. Let's. You know what? Keep talking about the band. I'm going to count them.
Okay, yeah. The two most important ones are Mavers and Power. That's, I'm like, beyond that, fuck everyone else in this band. I may or may not bring their name up. So, yes, they signed a Go Disc in 87. First single put out, Way Out, which is on the album.
Yeah.
No source for it, but allegedly praised by Morrissey.
I mean, that is the most believable. You don't even need a source for that.
Yeah.
And he's like, wasn't for me.
And then another surprise in this band's history. There She Goes was originally released in 1988 and it failed to chart. Imagine a world where this song fucking fails to chart.
Well, they would have found something equally fitting for Plan B pills on a commercial, I feel like.
I feel like that song's pretty perfect.
It is perfect for that. By the way, I hope I didn't miscount. I probably did because I did fast. 26 members total. One album, 26 members in and out.
This is
one of them's name is James Joyce, which is kind of funny.
That is funny. This isn't even like a Slipknot or an Arcade Fire type band where you have like 20 people in it at one time. No,
just simple four piece looks like, or three piece,
maybe five on a good day.
Yeah, this is a lot. Holy balls, man.
So now we get into the nitty gritty. They spent 2 years recording and re-recording this album. With a revolving door of musicians and producers, with only Mavers and Powers being the consistent two. Overall, 12 sessions. The producers range from John Porter, who worked with the Smiths and Brian Ferry, then John Leckie, who worked with Ecstasy, T-Rex, Public Image Limited, as well as so many bands. This guy,
a lot of bands that people are expecting us to cover pretty soon, actually.
He's
hoping we'll cover.
This producer's had a very like prolific career. I stopped reading at a certain point. Yeah. He's like a workhorse. And then Mike Hedges was another producer who worked with The Cure and Susie and the Banshees. And then he's here. I kind of dig some of these songs. I went and checked out the Mike Hedges.
Oh yeah.
I kind of dig it. And it's cool. They have all these different versions. Cause if you listen to some songs like back to back to back, you can see how all these different people viewed this band very, very differently.
It's insane. Listening to the deluxe stuff and all the outtakes and all the other versions. It's very, very good for a historical or a historian type of point of view because, I've heard the same song a million different ways, and it is, man, it's like production really fucking matters, man.
It does. It's funny because, like, the Mike Hedges stuff is very, it is, like, darker. You totally get why he's, like, worked with The Cure and Susie.
Like, grittier, too.
Eventually, Steve Lillywhite and Bob Andrews would end up with the production credits. I feel like this is the most like fact by fact groundwork I've like laid down.
Right. I mean, it is one very important.
It's very long groundwork to get here.
Yeah.
So I don't even think they like Steve Lillywhite. I think it was this kind of like the label was like,
fuck it. We're not going to pull these names here. It's just,
How much fucking manpower, millions of dollars and time. And I think they're this like, fuck it.
And I will say worth it. Totally worth it.
Goddamn.
Totally fucking worth it. let's get into it. You ready?
Let me cue this up after.
Ooh, boy. So here we go, everybody. And there she goes. That's stupid. That was a bad joke. S is 1990s, The Laws.
If you want, I'll sell you a life story.
I thought we were getting like a 90s band.
We are not. This is, it's like, he's alive. It's very 60s influence, extremely 60s influence.
Yes, and I think ultimately that's one of the factors why I don't like it, because...
You don't like 60s? You don't like 60s?
I do, but like... Not specifically this song, but a lot of stuff on like... You're just like a Beatles Who tribute band.
Not even fucking... Ooh! I'm gonna punch Alex right now. This song is beautiful. I think this song does exactly what an opener should. It lays the groundwork. It's simple. It's super fucking short. It's like less than 2 minutes. Mm-hmm.
Most of the songs are short except for the last song.
Another thing I want to talk about at some point. He's doing time in the back of his mind. He could hit the box. I like that woodblock. That woodblock is really working for me.
That woodblock fucking makes the song.
That's the thing. That's what I mean about the production. So,
you take that woodblock out of there, and this is coming from someone who doesn't even really like the band. You take that woodblock out of there, that song's nothing.
Then that means nothing if you don't like the band. I think you take the woodblock out, it's fine. But I still like the woodblock. And the way they do instrumentation here, even though having heard all of the other versions, as a whole package, this is fucking unmatched. Like,
you agree with the version that was
totally the way everything just ends up coming across. Like, so songs like that are a good example. What's another really good example? Where is it? Doldrum is another good example where everything in production feels like it carved out space for the next instrument. Mm. Like, so there will be, let's say the guitar line is not. They're not hanging on chords. It's very staccato. Mm-hmm. In between, in the silences, you'll hear a percussive instrument.
Like a woodblock.
Exactly. Yeah. So there's always something filling up the space that another instrument leaves. Mm-hmm. So it creates this very wide, like surround sound almost kind of production, even though it's not there's not a million people on these songs, but it does feel way bigger. So I think just from a production standpoint, it's kind of fucking brilliant, even though these are simple ass songs.
Yeah. But how do you hear I Can't Sleep and not think of The Who?
Because it's way better than the fucking Who. I don't even care for The Who that much. Tommy's great. Everybody likes Tommy, but that song is fucking awesome. I love thing is, I Can't Sleep was like the, I thought I had them pegged already. I was like, all right. So like simple riffs. And then I was like, hey, they're still elaborating. They're still very smart songwriting, but it's very simple. And then at a certain point, like, oh, these are, there's a lot of diversity here. You get like the wimpy, wimpy but nice timeless melody.
That song was interesting to me because it kind of like you think you're getting kind of like a Smith song, but it like ebbs and flows and it has like 90s alt rock elements and then even, you know, some Beatles elements.
There are definitely Beatles elements, and all the Beatles elements are early Beatles elements, which.
Oh, yeah. Like.
Meet the Beatles, please.
Yeah.
I was just gonna say, please to meet me. That's replacements. Whatever.
Twists and Shout.
So I think Liberty Ship is like, it's a little bluesy, but it's very, the vocal harmonies are extremely Beatlesy. Very fucking cool. That was the song. I was like, okay, I'm on board. I'm fully on board at this point. Liberty Ship was the one. I was like, all right, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go. I already like it.
That was the song where I was like, how many times are you going to go to that Who well and take water out of there?
It works. Who cares? It's better than the fucking Who.
It's not.
It totally is. I really don't care for the Who that much, though. Actually, one thing about Liberty Ship, that's the, out of every song here, that one has like this weirdly muffled production compared to every other song. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, given the history of it, it makes like all clearly.
They should spend 5 years George Lucasing a special edition version of this album.
I disagree. It's perfect the way it is. And then obviously There She Goes is literal commercial music. Literal commercial music.
That song. I want to know how many people picked up this album and were like disappointed.
They couldn't have been, because that song is the weakest in a sea of great songs.
But that song is why they picked it up.
Yeah. I'm saying like that is, it's not, that song is not that different than the rest of them.
Yeah.
But it's just not as good. So I don't think anybody was disappointed from buying this album for that song.
I feel like it's kind of misleading. Like,
it's misleading in a good way. Because like, I think even though I don't like giving the masses any kind of credit, I think you're giving not enough credit to the accessibility of these songs.
It's short.
Extremely digestible.
Yeah.
And even though there is some complexity, it's never alienating. It's always very... You're never confused at what's happening.
No.
Yeah. Go ahead. I was already.
Oh yeah. What the hell was that? Yeah. That, I don't know. I was just like listening to this album. I thought it was, you know, I read the like some of the hype for it. You know, it's one of the greatest one-off albums ever. And then I thought I was getting like 90s alternative. I'm like, that's not what I'm getting.
No.
And then I'm like, okay, so it's like some sort of 60s, 70s throwback thing. Okay. And then what the fuck? I was not expecting that song in the slightest.
Oh, yeah. Neither was I. But the same way I wasn't expecting shit like Freedom Song, which is like a novelty Russian jig song. I love it. I adore that bullshit.
And even then, still very like 60s, 70s.
Kind of. I mean, there's a lot of 60s influence, but it feels so entwined with the 80s-ness, which is why it feels so unique and fresh. Like everything about these songs feels unique. It's like they're 60s fans who lived in the 80s. That's exactly what they were. And that's exactly what this album ends up coming out as.
Yeah. Also this living in Liverpool, I'm sure, you know, it's hard to escape it.
Oh, the Beatles-ness.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now I have family in Liverpool and I was talking to my cousin about that. And it's like, him talking to my cousin, my brother, about that. Like, there's not that many people from Liverpool. Like, I think people think Elvis Costello is from Liverpool. I don't think he's not, though.
Why did I think?
It's one of those things. Yeah. I think it might be a Mandela effect. Maybe he is, and I just misremembered hearing that. I'm going to double check as we say, but I don't think he is. But yeah, like, I never heard, no one brought these guys up. Like, you think they would, you know?
Well, there's 20 of them. So, like, I was reading about, like, you know, side projects and bands that spawned out of this. And at a certain point, I got exhausted and I was like, I don't know who any of these bands are. So I'm going to leave it at that.
Costello's from London. Yeah.
Okay.
It's weird that the world is so familiar with these guys, but not really.
Yeah, that one song, and then someone covered it too, and then I think it was featured in She's All That.
Whoever fucking covered it on that commercial, I want to kick him the fucking ovaries, dude, because it was a girl singing, but like it's a worse version.
I mean, it's made for like the commercial, right? Like,
it could have been, but you never know. Sometimes it's already out there. Sometimes they commission it.
There's a man. I fucking can't think of it. Speaking of, there's like another song similar to that where I like have like the lady vocals in my head from like a cover song, but it's like actually like dudes originally.
Yeah, this one, it's like, even this version,
he does have like falsetto.
He does do a falsetto, so it's not like it's that different.
No, it's
vocally.
Not.
It's just little things in the production, like just like again the instrumentation, the spacing between instruments is it makes an actual fucking difference. Like, it makes me enjoy a thing more than I would otherwise.
Yeah,
I think it's like there's actually the slight changes to the actual bass lines, are in this version too, like things that are more interesting, minor, but still.
I looked them up performing on Letterman, and they are the most normal looking guys I've ever seen.
And like, they gotta be.
You would never expect that two of these guys are a psychopath and the other three are on their way out the door.
Wait, who's psychopath?
Oh, I'm just assuming going through that many.
I said, no, because I would do the same thing. If something wasn't working and you had a vision for it, and the people aren't doing their job right, you got to fucking find someone new.
Proving my point. You're a psychopath.
I am a psychopath. I've totally fired people. I'm like, I'm just going to do it myself. Like,
I think you and what's his fucking name?
Lee Mavens.
Yeah, I think you guys are just kindred spirits, and that's why you
maybe.
That's why you respect this so much.
Mavers, I said Mavens. maybe, but also I just appreciate like a well-constructed song that doesn't go out of it. Like, here's another thing that I really love about this, every fucking song on here, is that, and about the album, even from a wider, greater perspective, is that I don't want a second album. I don't want any kind of reunion. I don't want other EPs. This feels like they spent years writing these songs and getting them to the point where they finally came together. They finally found the right, like, everything kind of came together for this one collection of 12 songs, and that's it.
Yeah,
like, I don't want to hear more songs like this.
Yeah,
these ones just work.
Yeah,
it's a perfect contained unit of an album that can exist only unto itself.
You know, it's funny, and I'm sure it exists if like all the cast-offs like started their own bands.
All 26 of them.
Or no, you just or you just have like 3 or 4 bands that were formed.
If they all sounded like this, I wouldn't listen to any of them probably.
No, yeah.
It's not that I don't like the style. It's just like there's something. It's like I'm not going to say lightning in a bottle. But there's like a certain chemistry that comes together for one moment.
Well, I was going to say lightning in a bottle would imply.
Oh, that you can do it repeatedly.
Or no, that it, you know, happened. You know, they came together this once, but this is the product of years and years.
No, I know that, but I'm saying like the final result is the lightning. Like the fact that they're done. They have this one piece of, you know, history to, that's what they were, even though that's the thing with like crazy you know, production histories and how albums end up coming out, what you got is what you got in the end. Like, no matter how long it took to get there. Like, I heard my brother told me recently that it took like I don't know if it was a year or 2 years for the artwork for Earth AD from the Misfits to finally get finished.
Really?
That's why it came out in 83. Like, they're already pretty much breaking up.
Yeah.
But it's because they're waiting on the artwork. So it's like,
I guess that kind of makes sense before like computers and
Totally. And then, well, to be fair, my artwork is coming very slowly as well. Yes. But that's the thing. Like, that if you take away that aspect, like, oh, that album should have came out in 81 or 82, like, that's a whole different, that's a world apart in that scene. But what we got was the very last, like, tailing on the end of a lot of hardcore scenes in 83 mm-hmm. with this giant Misfits album where they went nuts. So I like that aspect of, this is what happened, and they broke up immediately after this, and this is all we got.
Yeah, or did they break? Yes.
Was it immediately after?
Oh, yeah, they stopped in 92.
Okay.
And then they'd sporadically get back together throughout the 90s and mm-hmm. early 2000s. Probably even, I think I read as recently as 2015, maybe.
Really? Holy shit. It's super...
No, if they're getting, like, if they can still tour and they're getting these show offers, I agree. Don't ever record anything else.
Oh, yeah. What for? Nobody cares about...
Fucking ride this.
Also, the window's closed. The window's closed. You got, like, where nobody's wanting a 2022 Laws album.
I think there's probably a lot of people.
They don't count. We're not talking about them right now. We're talking about the fucking psychos who like the old shit.
Because, yeah, this album is, like, for me, lives in infamy, but most people, you know, it's like...
Oh, this is going to be on rotation for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. And that's the thing. Like, I might even discuss every song. And it's like, I know you feel very samey about all of them, but shit, like... Again, like, Freedom Song comes out of fucking nowhere. And then you get a bunch of, like, a lot of dive bar hard rock stuff, like Failure.
Mm.
And
one song that I kind of, probably my favorite song on the album, Looking Glass.
Looking Glass is an epic.
Yeah.
And an album full of 2-minute songs, you get fucking 7-8 minutes. How long is it?
Yeah, it's about 7 minutes. And yeah.
No, it's almost 8. Yeah.
Oh, shit.
8 minutes.
Yeah.
It's a full-on ballad. Oh, god damn. It's, unlike anything else on the album.
Yes, it is. A lot of times we talk about, you know, these long songs where it's just like, didn't need to be that long. But, you know, this song earns every second.
It does. Like, it spends a lot of time with just an acoustic guitar and vocals. Like, it's setting you up. And then when they start, everything starts coming together and then it starts speeding up like crazy toward the end. It's fucking... deep as shit. And it's not common at all for a super long song on an album full of short songs to not feel like a long song. Like, they always feel weirdly long. The first thing that comes to mind is Terraform from Shellac, which is like, they open the album with a 12-minute song and every other song is like 2 minutes.
Oh yeah.
And it feels wonky. Like, I like the album, but it feels uneven. This, it's like, oh yeah, you should end it with this. This is great. I don't know. You talk.
Speaking of, I don't know where this comes out. What's the episode before this?
We just did Porcupine Tree.
If you guys aren't tired of 12-minute songs yet.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
Damn. Yeah. I guess it goes by quick. You know, I never felt like, Jesus Christ, put me out of my misery.
35 minutes, short as fuck.
Yeah, I even, you know, was interested enough to check out the different things. And like I said, Mike Hedges' version of Way Out.
Way Out is one of my favorite songs of
this. You know what? Because this is a short episode, I'm going to play that, the Mike Hedges' version.
Go ahead.
Because it's so different from the version on the album.
I love pretty much every version of the song. Oh, I love this shit so fucking much. I love this song. Give me one
last kiss. It sounds, you know, like that little, like, echoey.
Yeah.
Production.
It's a lot of chorus on it. Yeah. The vocals and guitar. Those are brilliant progressions. The way it switches to this type of riff after that kind of angelic, finger plucky stuff. Oh, I love it too much.
There's I haven't used this word in a while on the podcast. There's like an ethereal element with that, with that version that I dig.
Yeah, there's a lot of chorus on everything. But even with the album version, Which, in my opinion, if that version feels a lot more like Southern rock, mm-hmm. feels a lot heavier in that sense. But that guitar, I don't know if it's chicken picking or not, but it sounds like it. A lot of arpeggios, very fast. It kind of reminds me of a lot of stuff that Baroness does.
You know, yeah.
Where there's always this weird, crazy chicken picking thing going on in the background while there's still a vocal line. Yeah. I love that shit because that kind of stuff creates re-listen value, because on first listen you're listening to whatever is the most in front, and then on repeat listen you're like, wait a minute, I wasn't paying attention to this. So you can just focus on a completely different instrument for the whole time. So that's how you open up songs.
In a world of Third Eye Blinds and Wallflowers, who I guess came after this, but you know,
I haven't heard about the Wallflowers. Wallflowers and Jesus Christ.
In a world of those guys, I guess there is like no reason to do that. But you know, here they are, opening up the '90s with a '60s '70s throwback.
I love it. I'm so glad. I mean,
and
it
became one of the most '90s songs ever. What a fucking!
It is strange, and it really.
Do you like IOU? Of course, you like all the songs.
Well, IOU is my is. If it wasn't for There She Goes, it'd be my least favorite.
Okay.
It's fine. It's weaker than the others, but I still like it. That one has that's probably the most 60s influence, I feel like, on that song. When I see 1990 on this album, there's nothing 1990 about this.
No.
It feels like if it just got delayed. And it technically was, but it was because of production reasons. So this is not like, I'm almost conflicted. Like I always feel like when I hear of albums like this, like, oh, it should have been like, oh, recorded in 84 and then, but it was finally released in 90.
Yeah
it's totally that. It's not exactly that, but it's basically that.
You know what, you know what would probably be good would be like a mini series about the chaos of this band.
Oh, you mean like a Wu-Tang?
Yeah.
That one show? Like a dramatization?
Yeah. I would watch a dramatization of like the recording of this album.
Oh, but I hope they were maniacs about it. I hope there's fucking like Gordon Ramsay all over the place.
There's no way you aren't with that turnover of band members and producers.
You can do it politely. I don't know, but I can imagine like a fucking heavy scout sax.
And you know, if they did do it politely, that's why I'm saying I want a TV, a fictionalized, you know, made up version. If they did do it politely,
dude, man, it'd be so much funnier if they were polite about it.
Yeah,
it's like, I'm so sorry. You're just not right for
all 20 members get together like a family reunion, and they all really like each other a lot.
Jesus Christ, that's definitely not what happened. the more I talk about it, like these guys are fucking assholes, probably.
yeah.
But I like it a lot.
Oh man, damn. I still feel like I'm like hallucinating that.
Oh, I'm just gonna. This is the thing. On first listen, I was like, "Oh, this is so unquestionably great." I'm just gonna tell everybody to listen to this album. That's how much I fucking like. Oh, who wouldn't like this album? I can't believe you don't like this album.
Yeah, I take notes on my first listen, but the first listen, I was like, "Oh, brother." And then on second and third, I took my notes, and I was just like, "Oh, man."
See, notes on first listen, all pleasure. The rest, all pleasure. The rest of the way.
Holy shit! Yeah, it's just ultimately too much nostalgia for me. I guess
it didn't feel nostalgic. It felt like what I always beg for with bands. Like they take a style and now we're gonna write our own songs with it. We're gonna twist it and make it a little bit more of us instead of that genre.
You know what I should have done? But the podcast now suffers. I should have read, after I like formed my own opinions, I should have gone and like read reviews to try to like see like what, or hear what like other people hear.
Oh, right.
Because it's like 5 stars, 10 out of 10. Not even 10. Like retroactively, like when it was released.
That's unusual to me that it was that well received when it released, because it definitely was a sore thumb. Nothing else sounded like that.
Mm-hmm.
But
I can see it too. Like in the, you know, coming out of the 80s, you got all these like synths and it's fucking like hair metals popping off, and then like drop this in the middle of all that.
Yeah, it's highly unusual. And to think that like Soundgarden was already putting out albums in this time period. Yes. Like that's unusual.
Heavy metal existed.
Dude, death metal was emerging. Death metal was emerging. Black metal in like a couple years. Like, or actually black metal was already kind of starting up a little bit in Norway. But
rap existed. Dude,
the scary rap. And then this is fucking there she goes. It's fucking cute, dude.
You know, it's funny looking at the cover. It passes for a 90s cover and a 60s cover. Like
it does. 60s because of the eye makeup, 90s because it's an eyeball.
Yeah.
I mean, it's very Disco Volante, you know, Mr. Bungle.
Kind of. Oh, yeah.
Except a little bit less weird. Which means I like it. I'm obsessed with eyeballs and I love eyes.
Oh, man. Yeah, that's another reason the album got you.
That was a coincidence. I was like, oh, this is a cool album cover. I better fucking like
it. Yeah.
Yeah. But I hope you enjoyed that, everybody.
That was everything about. I've just been like thrown nothing but curveballs with my journey with this band, to Mike's opinion with this band. I'm dizzy.
Oh yeah, you almost watched mom and dad get divorced right now, dude. That's fucking this is the ultimate form of the world gaslighting you. Imagine they're actually just like shitty. Fuck Alex, great album. It is a great album. I'm not lying. I love it.
They don't actually exist. There's some sort of like fever dream. Exactly. The world
the
has
laws. What the fuck is called the laws? Bad band name though. Bad band name.
I think I saw something stupid because it like sounded or was close to like the lads.
Mm-hmm.
The lods. That's why the lods.
Lods.
Yeah.
Lod. Oh, lod. There we go.
Yeah.
That was awful. I said I'm more Scottish.
That's why they did it too.
Because
you think it's the lad.
Oh,
with that accent, you think it's the lads, but it's the lads. In America, you don't get that mixed
up.
It's
just a stupid name to us fucking Yankees.
Yes.
But it's a little wordplay. All right. That's cute.
Yeah.
But I mean, we already fought. We already did all the band history. We did every song for the most part.
And yeah, there's so much like I can't even like keep track of all the fucking this happened and this band started because they're, you know, maybe bands will get around to, but for the most part, nothing.
Not a lot of spinoffs.
Yeah, or there are a lot of spinoffs, but I don't think they were very like
successful.
Yeah, they existed purely in like the underground. So I mean, some of these bands have their own Wikipedias, so they're
big
enough.
Because what the fuck else did Lee do? He's had to have.
Oh yeah. I think I saw maybe he did something with the damn drummer.
Rat Scabies?
Yeah.
Oh, that guy's a fucking scumbag. Holy shit.
I'm starting to think Evers might be.
Man, he looks really, really like an alcoholic.
That wouldn't surprise me.
Either. His eyes are so red. He's so for sure an abusive alcoholic. Maybe. I'm probably just slandering him.
You gave him enough. Oh, yeah. That's not a flattering Wikipedia picture. Someone give this man a better Wikipedia.
Sometimes there isn't one. Dude, you wouldn't believe how long I searched to find flattering photos of Cedric and Omar from Mars Volta. Those motherfuckers are not pretty.
I don't know. I think I could have found some.
I found a couple, but it took a while.
So John Power formed a band called Cast.
Okay, that's the one. They have
four studio albums. There's another band called The Onset.
Lee's other one was called, Nukion?
Yeah.
I don't even know what the fuck. And there's nothing on them. It was before the laws.
There's another band called The Sand Band.
Huh.
God, there's so many. Where's the
none with the main songwriter? Like, all I want to hear is more shit that he's written and curious about what he did later, but it looks like he just succumbed to alcoholism.
Maybe,
as far as we know.
Maybe. I'm trying to find the part where I read about Rat Scabies. What a name.
Oh yeah. We haven't done the Damned yet, but they are on the list. Rat Scabies, I think, started releasing albums under the Damned name, and it led to a lot of drama. And led to a lot of bad records, I believe. But I think they reunited with him recently.
In '96, Mavers began recording at the Arc Studio in Quay, London, owned by ex-Damn drummer Rat Skates. That's what it was.
Wait, Quay? Spell that.
K-E-W?
Oh, you mean Q.
No, K.
K-E-W?
Yeah.
Q. No, that spells Q. K-E-W? Yeah, Q.
A Q?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
You said Qui.
Sorry.
Yeah. Because Qui's a slur against gay people.
Oh, like, shit. Yeah.
I'm pretty sure. Because there's a band called Qui with David Yao and two other guys, two gay guys, I believe. Three piece. And I think it's just vocals, guitar, and drums or something like that. I don't know if they're still together, but I hadn't heard them in a long time. But if David Dow is there, you know they're fucking wild.
Yes, yes.
But
we just can't stop talking about David Dow.
We like him. We like the music that he does, even though he swallows microphones. He doesn't sing.
Yeah, he's our new Ornette Coleman. We talked about Ornette Coleman a lot on earlier episodes.
Way less skilled. David Dow doesn't do anything but mumble into microphones and get drunk and pull his dick out, really.
I don't know. Ornette Coleman fucking... His motto was, no one solos in the band, everyone solos.
All right, I disagree entirely. Fucking hippie. I don't know, no, he's not a hippie, but he might as well be a hippie.
He might have done like heroin or something. That's like the jazz musician's drug choice for some reason.
I don't know why. It's weird. That is true. Cocaine is the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that was just the 80s drug of choice in general.
90s heroin, you know.
Maybe. Grunge heroin.
Yeah.
A lot of heroin. Anyway, thank you all so much for listening and watching. Scott, I hope you enjoyed this, you son of a bitch. Yeah. You made us fight. I hope you like that. But goddamn, I enjoyed it. And yeah, he has more requests that we're going to get to. I don't know when, but actually, you know what? One of the bands requested, I'm not going to say which, half because I've got the name of the band, but other half because I don't want to give it away. One of his requests was also requested by another patron. Which is...
Oh, so we should probably fast line that.
First time in our history that two patrons wanted the same thing, and I'm very excited to do that. And for anything like this, man, I like him a lot.
Damn, I hope... Unless it's the Who or the Beatles, I hope I...
It's not the Who, damn it!
It's very Who-esque.
Who are you? What's the song they use for fucking CSI?
Yeah! Oh, fucking brain fart.
See, my excuse is that I don't like them. Your excuse is that you forgot.
You know, it's funny. I didn't realize on Who Are You, he actually says, who the fuck are you?
That's right. I remember that.
It's so jarring.
It is not common for a band of that era to be throwing in F-bombs.
No, and he does it so casually too. What we're saying fucked up, like, lyrics in older songs that this get thrown out in that fucking in that Rolling Stones song that was Nice Soul Singers. This go rape murder. Is this a shadow? What?
Not as bad as that, but what was the song? Fucking Thin Lizzy. Thunder and Lightning, was that the song?
Oh yeah, I like Thunder and Lightning.
God damn, it's so exciting.
Yeah, man, I love the simple rhyming in that. I love the way he pronounces God damn.
Yeah, it's extremely black the way he does it. Like, it's so passionate.
God damn. It's almost a cot damn.
Yeah, yeah, it's damn near Farouk from WWE.
Damn.
But yeah, thank you all so much for listening and watching. I hope you enjoyed that. I hope you go check out our other fucking similar bands of the era. I can't even call them post-punk or new wave. They're just, an entity.
60s, 70s worship.
That you're wrong. You're simply wrong. And all the comments will agree with me. You're just wrong. And if I find someone else that hates them as much as you or is as lukewarm as you, then I'll have a conversation. But for now.
Also, yeah, in the comment section, don't direct it at us. But like, if you hate them or love them.
Yeah, just simply state your opinion and never say a bad word about anybody.
Not to us, yes.
That's what the internet does. They like listening.
Yeah, share your feelings.
Bring it. I don't give a fuck. Take it. I'll take it. But yeah, thanks for listening and watching. Subscribe, all that bullshit. Like if you like us. Don't if you don't. You can follow us on all the places. What am I talking about? I did my plugs out of order, so I'm just gonna.
You didn't even plug in the beginning. You were so
We jumped into it. It's okay, baby. Yeah. It's okay, baby. Pander Monkey. All right. All social media and Twitch. You can follow Alex
at Mother Puncture on Instagram.
Hell yes. Patreon.com/ every album. I almost said a different podcast name because I've heard them say it so much. That would have been bad. Plugging a different podcast in our podcast would have been an accident. Every album ever. Patreon.com/ every album ever. Bonus episodes, early access, certain episodes, discounts off merch. Of course, you get to jump the line like Scott did. Tier 2, you get to request fast track. Was it a fast pass, essentially.
Fast pass. You don't like waiting in lines at the amusement park?
The difference between us and amusement parks, though, is that even if you wait in a long line, you'll get on the ride. We have requests from like 2 years ago we have not gotten to because
Rocket from the Crypt.
Oh, fuck. I fucking forgot. We'll get to it sometime, or you can pay us. It's too many, but you can do that if you would like. You can find the full Lost album in the description. Usually we have playlists, but this time one album. Who gives a fuck? We'll put the whole album. And I guess that's about it. And because Alex loves this band so much, I'm handing it over to Alex.
Yes, I'm taking last song.
I haven't thought about it. I didn't think.
Well, you got like 12 songs.
I do got 12 songs.
Hoping this play there she goes.
I would rather punch myself in my own nuts. But this is harder than I thought.
Hard times. Well, you can cross out. There she goes.
I can't.
IOU's not fucking happening. Just fucking play the last song.
No, that's 8 minutes. I think that's 8 minutes.
All I hear is you don't want to hang out with me for another 8 minutes.
I'm mad at you. I don't want to be able to see your fucking face for another minute, Alex.
Yeah.
You know what? I'm going to go for one that we didn't talk about, but I think is what kind of turned me when I was like, all right, I'm already, nothing could turn me back from this album. That's Feeling.
Okay.
Hell yeah. So thank you so much for listening and watching. See ya.